mathematics pedagogy from our institute. This webinar series started a few months ago with the objective of promoting mathematics education to make mathematics education easy, more interesting in teachers and students. This platform was shared by resource persons for the last few months from various institutions like Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education, from international schools, B.Ed. colleges, etc. The topics they dealt with was various pedagogy of teaching mathematics at different levels and pedagogical content knowledge, etc. Today's resource person is Dr. Veena Deshmukh Madam, a senior most professor from the field of education, and also Madam was is a friend of us for at least last 3 decades, and we were interacting with her in different capacities and different levels. She had also interacted with us and with our college. And her experience and knowledge is vast. And her today's topic is what Dr. Vini said is a really very interesting, discovering aesthetics in mathematics. So when I was looking at the title, I was thinking, I understood that the title says that aesthetic in mathematics means there is some beauty in mathematics, and that beauty should be discovered, or we have to use that beauty to learn mathematics and to start liking mathematics. Like, so I was thinking, and a few questions came to my mind. So what is beautiful in mathematics? And where is that beauty lies in mathematics? Is the aesthetics of mathematics is the definitions and the formulas and the theorems, or the beauty is in the work of the great mathematicians? There lies the beauty, or the aesthetic, the pleasure we get from the abstractiveness and orderliness of mathematics, or mathematics is an art form and we enjoy the art. Or last, I was thinking that or the beauty of mathematics is in the pedagogy of mathematics, and we are using different types of pedagogy, and is the beauty of mathematics lies in the different pedagogy we use, or the when we use different types of pedagogy, the experience we get, so the beauty lies in it, or what is the result of it and the beauty lies in that result? I don't know, but anyhow, Madam, Veena Madam has a vast experience and vast knowledge. Definitely, Madam has the answer to all our questions, where exactly the beauty of mathematics lies. And also, I have somewhere I read that the most important creation, or the most beautiful creation of human being is mathematics. So I think so, Madam is going to speak about today all these things about the beauty of mathematics. And on behalf of St. Xavier's Institute of Education, Manager Father Blaise D'Souza, all faculty members and all participants, I welcome Veena Madam to this webinar for this series. And also I welcome our father, our manager, to this session. And on behalf of the Institute, I welcome all the participants. And the appreciation is there to Dr. Vini Sebastian. And she is the one who is conducting this webinar. And every month she puts lots of effort in conducting this webinar. And she chose the right person and experienced person for this webinar. So all praise and all appreciation to Dr. Vini also. Keep it up, Vini. Take it ahead in the same spirit. Thank you very much. Once again, I welcome Madam and all participants to this webinar. Over to Dr. Vini.
Thank you, Madam. And thank you for your appreciation. And Madam has already oriented us with the different areas we need to think about when we are talking about aesthetics in mathematics. So once again, good evening, all the participants, and welcome to this mathematics webinar series 5. We are so happy that we could go through the 4 webinars, and this is the 5th webinar series, as ma'am has said. And reminding you all again that St. Xavier's Institute of Education has taken up this challenge of coming to you all every month and we have dedicated people who are attending our webinars. And we hope through these webinars, we are making a positive difference in the mathematics teaching learning. We request you to share your success stories with us by sharing a 1 minute video of your innovations with us. Every webinar, we request the participants to share with us the 1 minute video on our email ID, mathslearning@sxi.in. mathslearning@sxi.in. So with these words, I would like to hand over the charge to Clarice Lemos, who will be introducing our speaker today. And we all are very eager to listen to Madam. Over to Clarice now.
Good evening to one and all present here. Very fortunate to introduce our resource person for the day, who is Dr. Veena Deshmukh. She is presently the chairperson of BOS Educational Technology at Ascendity Women's University. Ma'am was the director cum professor at Center of Distance Education at Ascendity Women's University. Dr. Deshmukh retired as a reader in education from Srimati Kapila Khandwala College of Education, and her specialized subjects of teaching were education, educational technology, and mathematics education. Dr. Deshmukh has also published many books like Mathematics, Learning and Temperament, Pedagogical Analysis, Computer Mediated Information and Communication Technology in Education. Ma'am is a recognized PhD guide for Mumbai University, Ascendity Women's University, and Yashwantrao Maharashtra Open University. She is also a recognized MPhil guide at Mumbai University as well as Aleppa University, Tamil Nadu. Words and time may fall short to acknowledge the incredible amount of work ma'am has done in her field. We are very pleased and grateful to have you, ma'am, with us today.
Ma'am, can I start sharing the screen now with your PPT?
Thank you, everybody, and particularly the organizers of this webinar for thinking of such a beautiful theme and inviting me also for this particular topic. I'm very happy to join with you all. And yes, the theme of the webinar is also very interesting and very contemporary, particularly when mathematics is considered as a very difficult subject. I think, Winnie, we should start.
Okay, ma'am, I'm sharing the screen.
Okay, thank you.
Ma'am, are you able to view the screen?
Yes. So, good evening, all the participants. You have taken their time and joined this webinar. It shows that they are very much interested in mathematics, teaching and learning of mathematics. I see quite a few numbers here. What comes to your mind when you look at this theme? Discovering aesthetics in mathematics. Just now when the principal madam, Dr. Susamma, talked about what she is expecting and what she is thinking, her thoughts. What came to your mind? You also thought something very interesting? What will come? What is the next few minutes we are going to spend on here?
Ma'am was talking about beauty in mathematics. So we are expecting that beautiful patterns, beautiful designs related with maths will come up in the discussion.
Okay. So let us begin. Next.
Mathematics. it's art in mathematics, I feel.
Yes.
Ma'am,
is there art in mathematics or is there mathematics in art?
Yes, mathematics.
Ma'am, it's something which we don't come across, like it's not something which we see at first glance, but if we really go into the depths of it, we, you know, like unraveling the beauty in maths.
Okay, okay. See, different thinking, but all are conserving to one particular aspect about the beauty. Okay, next slide. Next slide, please. Yeah. So this particular theme has involved with two words, aesthetics and mathematics. So what are they? What is the meaning of these two words? Why we should find out something about them? And how can we go about it? On these three things, we'll concentrate today. We have a limited time with us. So, and the topic is so vast, so we have to limit ourselves to some particular things. Next. Okay. Here we are thinking of aesthetic, aesthetic object, and aesthetics. Okay. So aesthetic is like related to the enjoyment or study of beauty. Finding enjoyment in beauty. There is beauty everywhere, but we have to enjoy it. The aesthetic object is the object which shows great beauty. And the aesthetics is the formal study of the art related to the idea of beauty. Next. What do you find, see on the screen? What are these things? In the nature, in the architecture, in science, is it the third figure? Is it science or it is the nature? It is nature, but how it happens in the nature is identified by the science, and the science comes from the maths. So it is aesthetic is creation and appreciation of beauty. Somebody has mentioned about patterns. So yes, it is through harmony, proportion and observing patterns in the nature. Next. Next please. Now there are certain basic facts we have to consider, sort of our axioms. The previous one, please. The beauty of the world exists independent of human consciousness. Even if humans don't see it, they are not conscious about it, the beauty is still there of the world. And beauty helps a person to accept the world which is surrounding him with admiration. So it is appreciation, admiring that beauty, which makes the person accept the world as it is. Now, mathematics gives us a mean for understanding this beauty of the world. It's a unique mean. Next. Now, a person discovers new places of beauty, new pieces of beauty, then tries to understand them, and then from that goes further and creates new products of beauty. Now, these pieces of beauty may be in the surroundings, may be created by other persons. But the person has to first understand and then create. So here is a picture of a forest. And these are the four lines, a poetry written by Paul Young. Now he has taken the name of Paul Young. What he says is, forests are where animals can breed, but trees are all gone because of greed. There must be something that we can still do, but do we still care with the things around you? what he has observed, what he has seen, and now what he is feeling about what is gone. And he wants to do something about it. So this is a form from the real experience, changing that real experience into a poetic form. Now, when you look at this poetic form, do you see any mathematics here? Read it in your mind or aloud without putting the microphone on, maybe. Is there any math involved? Are there any rules?
Hello, ma'am. Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think here in the screen in the poem, it's denoting about the number of animals which are staying in the forest. So they are depending upon the trees. So like there is a variation, we can say that.
Okay. So you are finding some mathematical concepts involved.
Yeah, over there. Because we are talking about the number of animals who are like, they can breed in the forest. But trees are all gone because of the green. So if you are cutting down the trees, naturally even the animals will also come down. Means they may die. So
good
some
answer.
Relation.
You are concentrating on the content.
Yes.
Anybody from the poetic form?
Ma'am, someone in chat has replied, it tells about relations. Each and everything in poem is related. And probability. They are talking about probability also.
Also, okay, good. Good answers.
The rhyming words which are repeated, rhyming
yes.
words.
There are rhyming
after
words.
After a particular number of words, the same yeah. rhyming words, the yeah. rhyming words are repeated.
Okay, and when you speak, when you say the poem, is there any particular format you use or you read it, like you read the prose?
Yes, ma'am, there is a rhythm to the poem.
Yes, so there is a rhythm also. Now, what is a rhythm?
Specific pattern.
Yes, it's a specific pattern where to break, where to begin. And if these are the lines, the rhythm is different. If there are shorter lines, the rhythm will be different. So everything is related to certain numbers. Next. Yeah, Azima, good answer. Next slide. Yeah. Now, what you are observing here is various artistic, architectural, astronomic, and musical creations, and some nature phenomena. They are basically some mathematical realities behind them. They are built up on certain general mathematical realities. So all these art forms or all this knowledge, the beautiful artifacts, everything comes with certain understanding of mathematics. That is what we want to find out, which mathematics is helping us. Okay, next. Next one. Okay. Yeah. The math wizard, the human computer, Shakuntala Devi. What she says about mathematics. Without mathematics, there is nothing you can do. And everything around you is mathematics. Can you think of some object where there is no mathematics involved?
I think there is no any object where mathematics is not involved.
Okay, Alsona is saying maths is everywhere and many people are saying that there is nothing, all answers are no. Okay, So it is the omnipresent nature of mathematics which is around the world, in our world. Now this is another quotation by Banach, who is a Polish mathematician, a contemporary, current. He is saying that the most beautiful and most powerful creation of the human spirit, that is what mathematics is. Next. Now think of when people are saying like this, that maths is everywhere and there is nothing, all of you are also agreeing to that, there is nothing without mathematics in this world. Then why people are so considered it so boring, dull, dry, and sometimes fearful subject? If it is such a beautiful subject, it is the beauty of the world, the basics are mathematics, then why it is that people are thinking of it as a very boring, dry subject? I was talking to my 12-year-old grandson, and I said that this is the topic on which I have to conduct a webinar. And I just asked him whether he will help me. He said, no, it's very boring. I said, because you don't know it, because you don't
ma'am, know it. Ma'am, maybe it is because the way it has been presented to us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So basically, it depends upon the educator.
Yes, maybe it is like that. But even we are never told how to appreciate it.
Yes, because exactly.
We are only dealing with numbers and figures. But what lies behind those figures that we never thought of? Consider
exactly.
An activity, because now we are in the webinar and we cannot do it, but try to do it. Draw some circles and then convert them into some figures. How many different figures you can circle into from the real world? Give answers. Whatever comes to your mind, you draw a circle, add something to it.
We can draw flowers.
Okay.
And we can draw a sun.
Okay. Come on, fast.
Ring. We can draw a ring.
Mm-hmm. We can draw
a merry-go-round.
We can make out some vessels from it.
Oh, yeah.
We can draw eyes.
Mm-hmm.
We can draw wheels
of the vehicles.
Right. See, all these have their basic structure as a circle, what you are thinking of. So from morning sun to the night full moon, everything around us is some form of a circle you can make out. And what is a circle ultimately? Think of a triangle. Go on increasing the number of sides and go on decreasing the length of the sides. What do you get?
Circle.
From triangle to quadrilateral to pentagon to hexagon to two octagon and so on, ultimately you get a circle.
Okay.
From polygons, when you go on decreasing the sides, length of the sides, the ultimate form. So it is a basic form of all geometrical shapes. Look at the beauty of it and look at the creations in the world, if you think God has created. And therefore, Galileo is saying that mathematics is the language in which God has written the universe. Another beauty of mathematics is that it is a language and it is a universal language. Nations and countries get bifurcated because what language they speak. Somebody is speaking Spanish, somebody is speaking French, somebody is speaking English, somebody is speaking Hindi. So there are lots of factions, and then there are people who fight over that. They want to have this language as their state language or that language, and so on. But what is mathematics? It's a universal language. It has its own vocabulary. It has the grammar, the sentences, mathematical sentences should be written in a particular format only. It has a grammar. It has a syntax. It has meaning. And there are people who use and understand it. So these are the basic things or basic criteria for something to be a language. And the symbols and organizations which form the mathematical sentences, they are same all over the world. The triangle which is drawn as a symbol in India will remain same in Africa also, or in Spain also. So that's why mathematics is considered not exactly as a science, it is more than a science, not exactly as an art, it is more than an art, but mathematics definitely is a language for people to speak, and it is universal, that is the beauty of it. Next. Yeah. So just now what we were considering about is every aspect of mathematics portrays some form of beauty. But today, because of the time constraint, we are concentrating only on the five forms: the symmetry, the mathematical theorems and proofs, the Fibonacci numbers, the golden ratio, and the fractal geometry. So you will also see that there is a step-by-step growth of mathematics further and further. That's why I have chosen these particular five topics. Next. We'll first start with symmetry. Now, what is symmetry? It is the idea of harmony of the universe. It is an ancient universal concept. You will find symmetry everywhere. Symmetry in science is awareness of the order and beauty. Oh, this is symmetric. So we become aware that yes, there is a beauty because the figures are symmetric. In arts, it becomes the product because you draw something, you make a musical notation, you build something, you create a dance performance, but here, whatever you do, you make it symmetrical. So because the product of beauty, and then you want to make it perfect, perfect symmetry in your art forms. Yes, Rangoli designs, that is your arts. But in culture, what we do is we see the natural symmetry surrounding us, which is visual, and we convert it into a scientific concept. See, the bird is flying in the air, and look at the wings. What a perfect symmetry when the bird flies. Okay. Looking at these figures, we convert them into our geometrical figures of symmetry of triangles and quadrilaterals. And we just make it dry as teachers. Why should we find symmetry in a rectangle? Because ultimately that symmetry is going to help us in creating something beautiful. And that's why even the drawing in the school, they have mathematics compulsory, or the drawing exams. The musical, you will find all the great musicians like Beethoven, Bach, they were very good mathematicians also. Pythagoras has designed the musical notes into fractions. He has made some relationship with the fractions and the musical notes. Next. There are umpteen such examples you can think of and give. Okay. Now, considering symmetry, it has three characteristics. It should have proportion, so proportionality. It is commensurability, so it should be commensurate, and it should be invariance. It should not have a lot of variance. And this is manifested by the transformations that is changing a shape. It is change of a shape. using something, some form of transformation. It is transforming from one place to other. Now, there are three types of transformations. One is flip. That is, it is a reflection, your mirror image. You are flipping it. Your right hand becomes your left side in the flip figure, and your left side becomes the right side. The second is turning. When the object is turned, it is a rotation. Now, in the rotation also, symmetry can be developed. And the third form of transformation is slide. You move from one place to other. So you just translate, you go further. Next. Now, when a shape uses these three forms of reflect, rotate, or translate, or combination of all these three, what you get is the earlier figure and the next figure are congruent. It is the congruency. Symmetry resulted into congruency because the shape remains the same through the transformation. While when the shape changes its size, that it resizes, with reflect, rotate, and translate, plus additionally resize, then you get similar figures. So it is congruency and similarity, which are the results of, or these are the two forms of symmetry which we find. Now look at the pictures here. What type of transformation you have observed? Is there any reflect, rotate, translate? Are there congruence? Is there similarity? Oh, the very first thing is, are they beautiful?
Yeah.
And then these beauties are result. Yeah, and then these beauties have resulted because of what?
The congruency.
Yeah, because they are very symmetric. They are very, very symmetric. Yes. They are through the transformations which has taken them. Can you give me some examples of these three types of transformations which are resulted into some form of beauty? Look at your clothes. Whatever you are wearing, are there any designs on the clothes you are wearing?
Yes, they have symmetrical patterns.
Symmetrical patterns with congruency or with similarity?
Congruency.
Congruency. No, yeah. Similarity patterns?
Similarity too. Both.
Yeah. Both are, yes, there, ma'am. Both are there.
Yeah. So some clothes may have. So, and why you always, you wear those clothes? Because you find them beautiful. But how they have become beautiful? Because of the symmetrical designing, symmetrical color combination. Yes, radials, very correct. The radial symmetry in the central figure. But what happens? Still it is congruency. The radial figure means your axis of symmetry is not a straight line. And it is going as a radius. And therefore it is radial symmetry. But it is congruent figures. Next. Now we find symmetry in nature also. The congruency of two fish or the congruency of two birds. Even you can find similarity also there, the baby and the mother. And look at this central part, this branch of the tree has become the axis of symmetry. On both sides of it, at equal distance, you find the congruent figures as they translate further. And as they go further, you will find a resized figure. So this type of symmetry we find in nature also. These are only some of the examples. You can think of umpteen number of examples. Even in your classroom, if you ask your students what mass they observe in the surroundings, whatever is dull in their notebook will become live in their environment. Next. Okay. We were just talking about symmetry in geometry, symmetry in nature. Now look at the numbers. Look at this number pattern. 1 into 8 plus 1 is 9. 12 into 8 plus 2. To that first one, 2 is added. And instead of 1 in the last, 2 is taken its place. So 12 into 8 plus 2, you get 98. And here 3 is added, 1 to 3. And the next, instead of adding 2, you are adding 3. And you get 9, 8, 7. Even if I am not given you the so many lines, you would have been able to do that, right? If I have given you the only the first 3, would you have completed till the last? Come on, look at the pattern. 1 into 8 plus 1, 12 into 8 plus 2. 123 into 8 plus 3. Yes. Yes. So once you have seen the pattern, you recognize that pattern, you see the beauty lying in that pattern, and then you can go further and further to stick to that pattern and creating something very beautiful. Now this person is saying, beauty of maths, and what he is doing, he is multiplying numbers with one digit, two numbers, and what he is getting out of it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Such a great symmetry. Next. It is the symmetry in numbers. Next, please. All of you are familiar with palindrome. As young ones, we used to make our own palindromes also, whether they were meaningful or not, but we used to make it. Here I have given you some language palindromes. Was it a cat I saw? No lemon, no melon. Eva, can I see bees in a cave? Step on no pets. Look at them. Read backward. They give you the same sentence. Now these palindromes we are knowing from the childhood in language. And we used to construct them also. Next. What about palindromes in maths? Palindromic numbers. The number itself is a palindrome because it is only single digit. In two-digit numbers, the number repeated itself will be all palindromic numbers. It is 11, 22. It is the table of 11. It is all palindromic numbers. When you look at this 1, 1, I have written on the right-hand side. I have added 1 and 1 and kept it as 2 at the center. But the side 1, 1, I have kept as it is. In the third line, I have added 1 plus 2 and written 1, 3, 3, 1. The side ones are same. Can you complete this pattern further? What will be the next one? After 1, 4, 6, 4, 1. Okay. It has been developed by Pascal, and therefore it is called as Pascal's triangle. But they are beautiful palindromic numbers. Yes, very good, very good. You are very fast. Next. Yeah, Zainab also. People are doing it faster. Now, look at the beauty of generating these palindromic numbers in such a simple manner. It can be generated from any number by making successive additions of the number with its reversal. I've given here some of the three examples. Like 67 plus 76, you get 143. Then you again go adding 143 plus the reverse of it, that is 341. What you get is a palindromic number, 484. Another example is three digits, and even in two steps, you get another palindromic numbers. Yes. The third one is two digits, which is obtained with three steps. Now, as we move further and further, we understand the functions and the mathematics formula behind it, using function, different types of functions also. But for small children, they just enjoy. See what happens to the numbers, how they become the same one and others. Okay, next. Here also I have given one example of symmetrical numbers from simple calculations. The first one, the last one which I already talked about. There is no need to actually multiply. Once you recognize the pattern, you will be able to get the answers quick. Next one. Here are some more palindromic numbers generated. Okay, next one. So what we have seen here is the symmetry, which is found in nature, which is found in mathematics, and which is found in numbers and geometrical figures. Now our next point was mathematical theorems. Now these mathematical theorems become the basis for the nature, for the universe, for the arts like music and drawing, painting, and even science. Next. Now look at what Colton is saying. He says the study of mathematics is like the Nile River. Because he stays there, he is saying Nile River. We can say like River Ganga or River Yamuna also. Begins in minuteness, but ends in magnificence. Like the flow of the river from the starting point till it goes into the sea. It starts with very small stream and then goes on getting wider and deeper and becomes a magnificent river. So I've given you here some basic example of how that minuteness goes towards magnificence. The very first figure is about geometric shapes or plane figures. From that you get a right angle triangle. You start considering properties of triangle and I have selected the right angle triangle. You further study the properties of right angle triangle and you get one of the gem of mathematics, that is the Pythagorean theorem. Once you have got this Pythagorean theorem, then you move towards the similarity of these triangles. It is the transformation using resize. And from the similarity of triangles, we move further to the branch of mathematics, which is trigonometry. From trigonometry, we move towards calculus, and so on and on and on, the magnificent mathematics becomes evident. Next. Look at the simplicity of the theorems. The geometry starts with a few axioms and postulates and moves further to prove many complex theorems. Next. Now, when the problem came to Euclid about whatever he started with his axioms, he could not prove the property of the angles of the triangle, some of the angles of measures of the angles of a triangle, he has to take one other property into consideration, which could not be proved. And therefore, it has become a postulate. Postulate is axioms and postulates are truths from which you start to develop the whole mathematics. With very few rules, you build the whole great grandeur building. So another postulate needed to be added. So with the parallel postulate that there is one and only one parallel line drawn from a point outside the line to the from the same plane, that was required to prove that some of the measures of the angles ABC of triangle ABC is 180. Now, what will happen if we disregard this parallel postulate? So, parallel postulate was saying there is one and only one line parallel to the given line. What are the opposite of it? For one and only one, for one, no line. And for only one, at least two lines. If it is not one and only one, then there should be at least two lines or either no line. Now you start this basic, disregard this Euclid's parallel postulate and next and consider these two different postulates. Next one. Next one. So you are getting no parallel lines or at least two parallel lines. This particular rule has been changed. This postulate has been changed. You get a whole different type of geometry. Look at the beauty. Look at the grandeur of this mathematics. A non-Euclidean hyperbolic geometry you get, which is also termed as Lobachevskian, and from the German Riemann on his name, for no parallel lines, that means all lines meet at infinity. There are no parallel lines. So a different plane. And then Riemannian geometry becomes the basic for studying the stellar objects. Okay, next. Have you understood the simplicity of the mathematical proofs and theorems? Very simple, basic things accepted, and more complex nature of theorems were proved. And they were proved on the basis of just logic and thinking. And they are applied to the whole universe. That is the beauty. Now, Fibonacci sequence. I think most of you must have heard it, and you may be knowing also about it. The set of numbers increasing rapidly defined as the next number is the sequence is equal to the sum of the previous one. You know how Fibonacci has come to this particular sequence of numbers? He was studying actually the breeding pattern of rabbits. And he made some hypothetical considerations while studying. In that problem, he has considered that no rabbit will die. So after every month, there will be an increase, because after every month, there will be a breeding. And so look at the numbers and look at the numbers, how they increase so rapidly. And how you get the next number. It is 0 plus 1 you start with. You get the next one at 0 plus 1, 1. Then 1 plus 1, 2, 2 plus 3, 1 plus 2, 3, 2 plus 3, 5, 5 plus 3, 8. I think you have heard these numbers. If not, any of you have not heard earlier, now you are seeing. Are they simple? You can definitely get the next one, next one, next one, till infinite. It will continue until you will be bored of calculations. But computers can do it in no time. Okay, next.
Next.
Now, how Fibonacci numbers are seen in nature? Now, many plants adhere to the Fibonacci numbers. There are fixed number of petals, and they are always, or most of the times, they are in terms of Fibonacci numbers. You get 5 petals, you get 13 petals, you get 21 petals. Then so on. Yes. Any question?
No, ma'am. Someone had left their mic on.
Okay. Next one. So once Fibonacci has made this series public, what he has found, people have started finding Fibonacci numbers in the nature, and then they studied the flowers. They have seen the definite number of petals in the flowers. Okay. Now look at this figure. What is done here is the squares are drawn as taking the Fibonacci numbers as the sides. So you got 1 plus 1, 2 plus 3, 5, 5 plus 3, 8, then a square with 8 and 8, then adjacent to it, it will be 8 plus 5, that is 13, then 13 plus 8, which is 21, so a square with 21 dimension, then 21 plus 13 is the 34, that is square with 34 dimension, and so on. And when you can start joining the vertices with a curved line instead of diagonal, what you get is a spiral form. And this spiral form is known as Fibonacci spiral. Have you understood how that spiral has come and how the diagrams is drawn from adjacent squares? Okay, next. Now this is a sunflower, and when you look at it through a magnifying glass, it becomes the next one, a bigger one, the central part. You go on increasing it again, looking from the magnifying glass. Look at the central part. What do you observe?
Spiral.
Are you seeing the curves? Are you seeing the curves, the spirals?
Spirals,
spiral pattern? Yes. So the Fibonacci number or Fibonacci spiral was already present in the sunflower seeds. Okay, next. It is not Fibonacci flower. It is the seeds at the center which form the spiral. Now in the musical notations, an octave on the piano consists of 13 notes, out of which 8 are white and 5 are black. What is 8? a Fibonacci number, 5 is the adjacent number to 8, which is, so you have white keys 8 and 5 black keys. Now when you are making a scale, the dominant note is the 5th note, which is the 8th note of all the 13 notes. So there are 13 notes, 8 white and 5 black. You look at the pattern, how they are created. And the 5th note of one octave, you will find as the 8th note of all the 13 notes, which make that particular octave. So even Fibonacci sequence we can find in music. Next. These are some of the objects in nature where you can see Fibonacci spiral. I think immediately you may not be able to see it, but the pine cones, the pineapple, the flower and the petals in between, the cycas plant and its bottom from where the cycas leaves come out, and the cycas leaves also. Then succulents, most of the succulents, they all see, they all make, they are already making actually the spirals, which now we know and we term them, yes, the eye of the cyclone, correct. So the cyclone also shows you those curves, the spiral of the Fibonacci series formation. Next. I'm giving you some other examples also. Please, next. No, previous to it. Previous one. No, earlier, please. One before. This is a drawing by a Japanese artist. No, not this one, the next one. The next one.
Ma'am, the great wave the... you want the great wave, no?
Yeah.
Ma'am, it is there on the screen.
Now it has come on the, now it has come. Okay. It is the great wave of Kanagawa. So Kanagawa is the place where it is drawn. It is a woodblock print. And it is drawn sometime. It is not very clear when it was drawn, but it is between 1829 and 33. Okay. And I look at the pattern there. How that wave has come. In that wave also, there is the Fibonacci spiral. Here I have imposed the spiral on the curve. And we long behind you see the Mount Fuji. Next one. Now, here is one activity. Are you aware of Fibonacci numbers and Fibonacci series spiral now? Now, here is an activity for you. Draw a rectangle selecting two consecutive Fibonacci numbers. So, sides are 13 and 21 or 8 and 13, not just 2 and 3. Okay? When you draw it, what will you get? Next. Yeah. Now what you have to do next is divide it into a square by drawing a segment of length equal to smaller number. So like breadth. In this rectangle, draw a segment which divides it into a square and a rectangle. Yes, very good. Then next, you have to do the same. Okay. One square, one rectangle, then further and further, one square, one rectangle, then still further. What do you get? go on doing it. What do you get next? Can you think of? Next one. Yeah, you get small square with a rectangle. Side by side, you have a rectangle also. Click. Yes. Next. Yes. You see the spiral on those rectangles joining the diagonals of the squares. Now look at here. You have the, yes, that's over now. The spiral what you get once you join those diagonals of the rectangles. So it's a very simple technique and you get a spiral. Okay, the next slide. Yes. Now what we are doing here is we are dividing the next number of Fibonacci with the previous number. So we are dividing 3 by 2, 5 by 3, 8 by 5, 13 by 8, 21 by 13, and so on and so on and so on. And if you look at the division, what you are observing here is that the ratio of B to A is moving towards 1.6, then further down, 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 1.6, 1.8. If you go on moving further and further, approximately you will get this value. It will be a constant. As you get bigger numbers, it will be more like that. Okay, next. So division of. Now, this is your Fibonacci spiral, and you have the diagonal of. Sorry, you have the sides of the rectangle, one as A and the other as A plus B, because you have a square of A and then the B. Okay. Now, when you are dividing this A plus B with A, that means the side of the bigger side of the rectangle with the smaller side, both are Fibonacci numbers. Then what you get is a somewhat constant number, but which is a like pi, it is an irrational number. It is denoted by pi, a Greek letter, and it 1.618033938, so on and on and on and on. So, like pi, we approximately take it as 3.14, we take the value of pi is 1.618. Okay. Now, why this ratio has been termed as golden ratio? This golden ratio means the ratio between two Fibonacci numbers which are adjacent. So, why this ratio has been called a golden ratio? Next. Most of the entities, biological as well as non-biological on Earth, follow this particular proportion for length and breadth. Even human forms, human body, if you consider as it fits into a rectangle, suppose, then the ratio of the breadth to the length, length to the breadth will be 1.618, following the golden particular ratio. So objects which fit particularly inside this pattern are considered beautiful or pretty. And why they are considered as beautiful or pretty? Because scientists are saying that our brain, the human brain, is hardwired. Means already it is fitting in. It is hardwired to accept this pattern as beautiful. So whenever we see this particular form, we say, yes, very beautiful. Because our brain has been trained. Not before, even before we born, it is hardwired. It is not the new neural connections. It is already formed as a form of beauty. Okay, the next one. Now, what is common in a snail shell and a hurricane? The eye of the hurricane and it is actually the whole hurricane, not eye. And it on the left-hand side, what you find is a shell of a snail, which is a very small thing. And the hurricane, yeah. What is common in both? The spiral, yes.
The spiral shape.
The spiral shape. But which type of spiral shape? It is not any form of spiral. A spiral shape can be of a different direction also. That this spiral shape is fitting to the rectangle which we have decided. Okay. So it is the Fibonacci spiral. And therefore it is the example of golden ratio. Next. Yes. Now the golden ratio, the famous painting of Mona Lisa by Leonardo da Vinci. Look at the proportion. It is fitting to the golden ratio, our rectangle of A and A plus B side. The Taj Mahal, the height of the minaret, the height of the main building, the smaller parts on the sides, and Parthenon. Here also you will find that it is perfectly fit. They are developed considering the golden ratio. This golden ratio has arisen from Fibonacci numbers or Fibonacci spiral. Okay, next. See how mathematics has resulted into this form of beauty. These people must be knowing from that time. Okay, next.
Madam, I would like to add one more Fibonacci spiral. Will you allow me?
No, I'm talking about here the ratio. It is not about the spiral. See, there is a difference. The Fibonacci numbers, when you make into a rectangle form and go on dividing it with a square and a rectangle, so that the after making the square, the next rectangle also is a following the pattern of Fibonacci numbers. But you have not made it into a spiral, you have just kept it as a ratio of these two numbers, the length and the breadth. So that is a rectangle. And the ratio of its sides. And therefore, that is a golden ratio. And spiral is when you join the diagonals of the squares into a curve. Instead of drawing a diagonal straight line between the two points, opposite vertices, when you join it with the curve, then you get the spiral. Now, that spiral is also found in many of the objects, mostly in the universe, particularly in the plants and animal kingdom. So we have started from symmetry, we have gone to the mathematical theorems based on symmetry and other things, and then we have come to the Fibonacci numbers and how they are in the nature, from the number of petals to the pattern to the swirl to the what earlier one of you have said about the radial symmetry, And now look at the conch, look at the seeds of the sunflower in at the center, look at the petals of the rose, how they are formed. So all these are giving us that ratio of length to breadth, which is 1.618 approximately. Next. So, is it clear now from Fibonacci numbers? Sorry, from Fibonacci numbers to Fibonacci spiral, then we have come to the ratio. The ratio is between the two numbers. And that ratio comes through that rectangle. So when you fit that rectangle onto the thing which has been made, then you get this particular shape. Now next we are coming to the fractal geometry. This is our last point today, the fractal geometry. Now our Euclidean geometry uses four topological dimensions, like point, which is zero dimension, then lines, which has only one dimension, linear, then planes, which are two dimensional, and cubes and spheres or cones, which has three dimensions. Next. Now, fractal geometry is a geometry which is mathematical description of complex shapes which are not described by Euclidean geometry. Yes?
No, ma'am, nothing. Somebody's mic is on.
Okay. Okay. So the properties here, what you find is there are geometric irregularities, means they are not the regular figures which are given in Euclid's geometry. Another thing is they can make self-similar. They can develop into the similar to oneself. And they have the size which is in fractions. They don't use integers. So if you have these properties, then you get fractal geometry. Next. Let us see what are fractals. Next. Yeah. This fractal geometry, as the word fractal has been coined by Mandelbrot, which means irregularity or fragmentation. It is a self-repeating pattern and which is at any scale. So what happens in the fractal, when you zoom an image, whatever image you have taken, if you zoom on it, what you get is a more defined and more clear image. But in fractal, what happens? You get more detailed image. So instead of the same image becoming more clear, it becomes more detailed. And this particular fractal, which is designed by the Mandelbrot set, known as Mandelbrot set. Okay. So these are called as fractals, and particularly they are used in computer graphics nowadays. And you can get 10 to the power 15, 20 times the iterations can be made, and then you can get beautiful shapes, and you will find them on your computer screens, and then laptops and all. Very beautiful products. And they have their own geometry developed. They have their own theorems, but which is instead of based the Euclidean geometry on regular figures, this has been based on irregular figures. And then this irregular figure is also developing self-similarity. That means the main figure becomes a self-similar to the other. I'll give you an example of snowflakes. If you consider a snowflake, one snowflake, they have different shapes. Even if they have all six, this dimension, six, this thing, you find at the end point of it, there is another part which is nearly the same shape. With some examples, I think you will be able to understand this better. But how beautiful things can be generated using fractal geometry and a new form of arts. Okay, next. Please play the video. What happens is the initial image, which contains one large fractal sequence, so this is the Mandelbrot set. Look at the fractal which he has created. When you look at the part which is coming front, you will see the fractal again. So the new fractals, maybe the speed has a little problem here, but you can really go home and look at your study or find out on YouTube. Very beautiful fractals created and how they have created. See the pattern? You see the spikes coming out? Each of those spikes in itself becomes the new one. It is little bit slow, and therefore you that continuity is missing. See the beautiful patterns which are coming out of it. So here, from symmetry and the transformation of symmetrical figures into by three ways, and then continuing it further and further to the numbers, Fibonacci numbers, and the spirals, and from the spirals to the ratio, proportionate ratio of golden ratio, or it is also called as divine ratio, because earlier everywhere the people were finding it, and therefore they were thinking of that it has been created by God. And that's why our brain is also hardwired to understand that. And see how detailing of it becomes. The newer one goes on, the same shape you will find. So it is particularly the designers nowadays who create these things. Okay. Got it? Have you seen the pattern?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. And it is the same, but a smaller size. Ultimately, it has every detail of the bigger size. And then it has developed further and further. Okay. Thank you very much for that. So what happened here is the image. Back to the slide. The initial image, which was containing one large fractal sequence with smaller fractals branching out from it, then when they are zoomed on, they become, that particular part becomes similar to the main fractal as the larger one fractal. And then that also has smaller fractal shapes branching from it. So when they are zoomed in, you get further and further the similar things. Okay. So this is a very beautiful, and it is possible what Mandelbrot may have made. At that time, computers were not available, maybe. But what today the computer graphic people can make using this is really, means there are no words to say how beautiful the creations can be. Okay, next. So underlying maths is what you find everywhere. Now, I was talking to you about snowflakes. Now look at the pointed ends of each snowflakes. It comes as the same as which is at the center. And at each of the end point, it will again become a now it is a macro level will become micro, and then again it when you zoom in it will become macro. So therefore no two snowflakes you'll find are as a same in shape, like they have the, but each one has a very great individual section. They have a symmetry at each individual section. Very simple example of it is plants, leaves in the plants or trees. So one from one big plant, small plants are growing. They are self-similar to the big plant, even when they are small. When you go on finding the details, it will go further and further. Okay, I'll give you one simple example of, say, cauliflower or broccoli. The bigger cauliflower, the bigger broccoli, and it has lots of pointed ends. If you look at them through a magnifying glass, you will see that they are the same shape but small size of the bigger one. And so they are going on, like the, you will see those fractures in nature. Okay, next. So fractal is a never-ending pattern. They are created by repeating a simple process over and over in an ongoing feedback loop. And therefore, they are images of dynamic systems. And therefore, they are very much related to, because computers can do it over and over, continuously ongoing, making the feedback loops, and therefore designing. Okay, next. Next one. Now this is the circles drawn by and which are also like the bigger circle is a image of the smaller circle inside and all that. Now basically our first question, that why students don't, so I think you have understood how we went from symmetry to mathematical theorems, Fibonacci numbers, to Fibonacci spiral, to golden ratio, ratio of rectangle of sides A and A plus B, and then which are the Fibonacci numbers basically, and then to fractal geometry, where the production is of similarity, like self-similar objects have been developed, and which is irregular function. Okay. Now these are computer graphics drawn by one Anne Burns, and she says that after studying that, she understood the beauty of mathematics because she has done it with Mobius transformation, doing the iterations. Now, how many times you are iterating the figure will give you the beautiful, more and more beautiful things. Okay. The first iteration, the second. It is like what you draw in Rangoli. Many times you have central figure, then on the side, then on the side. And then sometimes you repeat the smaller figures towards the end. But it is ultimately you are doing it by hand. If you start doing it on computer, it will be different. Okay. Next. Yes, mandala art also. Now this is what I wanted to tell you. See, consider a simple thing about like fraction. Now what we start with the formal notation only. Like 3/4 is a fraction. Students start getting confused because till that time they are knowing 3 and 4 as two separate numbers. And suddenly the way you are writing, you are saying it is not a full number also, it's whole number also. But this is just the tip of the iceberg. And this level has to be reached for understanding that 3/4, how many visuals, how many examples, how many things from the nature, the real life, the person should understand to finally understand the formal notation of fraction. normally this iceberg metaphor is given, that the teachers concentrate only on the tip of the iceberg, and the lower part is completely forgotten or not even taken into consideration by the teacher. And that's why students don't see the beauty of it. Where is the maths in their real life surrounding them? They don't see it. And therefore they think it is only numbers, and therefore, and only addition, subtraction sort of, which doesn't carry any meaning for them. Such simple thing like 2 + 2 = 4, what does it mean? We never have given emphasis that this 2 + 2 should be the same things from the same set. You can say 2 mangoes and 2 mangoes only can be added to become 4. You cannot add 2 mangoes and 2 apples. Or even in fraction, it is 3 out of 4. But those 4 should be equal parts is never stressed or emphasized by the teacher. So the complete wrong notations are formed from the early childhood. So basically visual representations, visual manipulations, actually working with the things is very important in understanding mathematics and the beauty which is lying behind it. Then only you will start appreciating. Then only the students will feel, yes, I should know it. Because as you know, in the beginning only we have said, you want to become anyone, mathematics is required. You want to understand anything, mathematics is required. So the utility of mathematics from morning till night, outside the home, inside the home, everywhere, it will be required. So please concentrate on the base of the iceberg rather than only the tip of the iceberg. And try to ask them to find more and more meaningful examples they can generate. Now, I think when you go home, you just search on the YouTube for practice, you'll get beautiful, beautiful 1 hour to 2 hours videos are there. Okay, next. So therefore we say mathematics is a mirror of civilization. How the human civilization has been developed can be seen in the subject mathematics. Okay, next. Next. Mathematics makes it possible to realize the perceived phenomena and objects and deepen our knowledge about the world. Now this, we understand the harmony about the world. Okay. The last one. Now this human figure has been made by strips, metallic strips of various dimensions and using mathematical symbols. This is a full statue of a human being. You see the perfect golden ratio. Even if you look at one part of the human being, you will find that golden ratio. If you look at the ear and put it into a rectangle, you will find that it is a rectangle which has been obtained from consecutive Fibonacci numbers. Even fingers, the whole human body is based on number 5 and the golden ratio. Okay, next. Next one. Yeah, these are the references. Yeah.
Ma'am, can I stop sharing?
I think yes. I thank you. Is there? I think one slide, and actually, I wanted to thank all the participants because they were very communicative, very enthusiastic, and they were responding also very well. And so, thanks to one and all the organizers, particularly Winnie and her students, Madam, and the participants and everybody. And whatever questions and queries you have, I think we can take up now.
Yeah. Hello, ma'am. What I feel is, madam, more than questions, it is lots of appreciation for you, because everything, all the presentation was so nice and it was so beautiful. So the last minute, there is no questions at all. We have enjoyed the session.
Can I say something?
Okay. Yes, father. Yes.
Can I say something?
Yes, father.
Madam, all that you have presented has been a very special discovery for me. And what I have learned from it, and what I think we should all learn from this, is that in God's creation, there is this beauty and this harmony which we need to discover. Harmony within myself as within the human person. And that is related to other human beings. So we are born and created to be in harmony within ourselves, with one another, and with the whole of nature and environment. And I feel if we were to learn this from our mathematics, there would be fewer conflicts in the world. We would learn to live in harmony within ourselves, with one another, and with the entire nature and environment around us. That is something I think we need to learn from what you have presented to us today. It was really a discovery for me.
Yeah, very. What you have said, Father, very true. We have to learn to appreciate, and it is not only appreciate ourselves as well as our nature, our surroundings, our environment, our people, everything. Then only the harmony of the peace of the world will live. Right. And mathematics is behind everything. Whatever you see, it may be found out now or it may be found out earlier. But there is a mathematics basis for everything.
In the beginning, I was wondering when the title was given aesthetics, I said, oh, mathematics and aesthetics. But what you have presented is something really great. And I wish we all were to make it part of our lives. Yeah. We will have a world full of harmony, really.
Thank you very much, Father. Thank you so much.
Hello, ma'am. I am just taking one minute time to ask you one personal question. Where are you now, in India or abroad?
No, India only, in Mumbai.
In Mumbai only. Okay. And how is Deshmukh, sir? Second question.
Yeah. He's also good now.
He's good. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Thank you, madam. Yeah.
She's in India, but in touch with the whole world.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
So,
we need no questions?
Yes. No. Also,
I think I'm being around.
Ma'am, I think there are no questions. Everyone is just like, they are just appreciating everything. Even on YouTube, lots of appreciation. Can't see any questions so far.
Okay. Sorry to interrupt, but this is teacher Anjita here. I have a small question. Can I?
Yes, sure.
Ma'am, this session was all about the aesthetic sense, right? What I want to know is, many of the students, suppose a child is in class 10th and he dislikes math. So at that stage, can a teacher help to develop that aesthetic sense now that he has crossed all those years of school?
Yes.
Or will it be a difficult task? Obviously, it depends on the educator and also the recipient, right?
See, there is one aspect, that is the understanding the beauty behind. the other aspect is finding the use of mathematics. How mathematics is useful to you in the life?
Yes.
That is, means what you are talking about, a person in the standard 10 and now he has to appear for the board exam. So why mathematics has been made compulsory? And not only now, it has been part of the 3 hours from early Greek time. So formal education, reading, writing, arithmetic, they were the 3 aspects. Now as and we go further, we get different branches of mathematics and they are still developing further. Because it is such a simple thing, you just change one rule, the whole game changes.
Right.
And it is everywhere. You will find it in game theory also. Whatever a person has to become finally in life, without mathematics, it is not possible.
Exactly.
Even these medical professions also, they require calculus, which is this for finding the heart rate, blood rate, how it is calculated means. Everything what is happening, just what I asked the question first and students have just answered that there is for everything they require mathematics. But you think of there is a mathematics regularity lying behind. And even this, you can ask the students to find out where this, even this Fibonacci spiral or Fibonacci curve or Fibonacci numbers, where can they find them? And now see what has happened. Google has been open for them. So where mathematics used, what mathematics used. See, they don't understand our world problems. Like they don't find its relevancy to the life.
Right.
Because many times we give world problems which are just for the sake of calculations.
Yes.
But the real mathematics which is required is the thinking behind. And that's why problem solving is one of the... Today my topic was not that, therefore I have not dealt with it. But problem solving in mathematics is ultimately lead the child to solving problems in real life.
Yes.
That thinking process needs to be developed. So I'm always concerned about that. Process is more important than the product in mathematics. Even if that problem is solved wrongly, but if his thinking process is developed,
yes,
then it is a good learning. Like we should be more concerned as teachers as what the child is doing to the mathematics problem rather than what the mathematics problem is doing for the child.
Yes.
We should have that concern. Yes. After Thank solving this problem,
okay. Ma'am, there was one question which has come up on YouTube. So this teacher finds it difficult to explain the concept of circle to the students. And more specifically, the participant is asking how to give examples for cyclic quadrilaterals.
Examples?
Yes.
I didn't get it.
Ma'am, just this was mentioned, how to give examples for cyclic quadrilaterals. Maybe the person was asking in terms of how to connect it with the real life situations.
Okay. Means what is its relation to?
Yes.
The real life.
Yes.
There are some theorems. I'm not in touch with the syllabus now. Much of. This figure inside the figure, no? So what properties remain? What properties change?
Yes, like I think this person is asking where can I find examples for cyclic quadrilaterals and angles in same segment?
I will try to give that properly. If you have her email, I will send it the answer.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Yeah, I'll sort of collect it and pass it on to madam, no?
Yes, yes, sure.
Yeah, okay. That is okay, like.
Yes.
there any other question?
No, ma'am, no questions.
No question. Yeah.
So before we close, I would like to present a small action research which we have done. So it is self-explanatory, so I will not be taking much time. So I'll just present. It is a few slides only. So the Mathematics Pedagogy Club has conducted a small action research, which we normally do with our invitation. So we this time we have done on a very interesting topic, understanding mathematics phobia for effective mathematics teaching. We had 125 responses, very less response compared to last time. But nevertheless, we got few answers, and we would like to present it in front of you. And we hope that, you know, that this problem is taken care of, and students really enjoy mathematics. At least after Dr. Veena's session, we know that there is so much of beauty in mathematics, and I hope that this problem is taken care of. So we present this topic. So the first question is, for mathematics phobia natural? So we can see that many of the teachers or participants, you know, have felt like, you know, that 37 people have felt that it is natural, and 13.6 people, they say it is they disagree with this. But we can see that, you know, at least 37% have said that it is natural. So is it natural to have mathematics phobia in the mathematics subject? Is mathematics phobia related to a personality type? So mathematics phobia is developed in introverts was a question, and there is, you know, very few have agreed, and many of them have disagreed to this statement, and they have strongly disagreed to this statement. So it is not related to any personality type. Is mathematics phobia related to the volume of the portion? So mathematics phobia can be controlled by decreasing the mathematics portion. That was the question. And they have said, many of them have disagreed to this question, that even if you, it is not the question of the volume of the portion, it is not related to the volume of the portion at all. Mm-hmm. Okay. So the children develop the phobia towards mathematics due to the teacher teaching mathematics. I think this question had come, and they have, it is written sometimes. So many of them have written sometimes, and very few have written agree. But sometimes and frequently, you can see that, you know, most of it, most of them have written sometimes and frequently. So somewhere people feel that it is because of the teacher who is teaching mathematics. Next question, mathematics phobia is because of the number of sums that are printed in the textbook. So many of them have said disagree. At least 50% have said, around 45% have said disagree. And many people, very less people have said agree. Some of them are also in the neutral position. Mathematics phobia is because of fear of failure. Then many of them have said agree. So because the children are having fear of failure, there is mathematics phobia in the students. And the only way of tackling mathematics is to practice mathematics every day. And many of them have said strongly agree. And there are agree and strongly agree. You can see around 78% have said strongly agree. So a lot of practice is required in mathematics, and people do feel that with practice, this phobia will decrease. Mathematics phobia can be decreased by making the child aware of mathematics, strongly agree. So the child has to be made more aware of mathematics, and it is strongly agree. 70% have said that. So that is what we need to do. And what are the reasons for mathematics phobia? Teaching methods, introduction of mathematics at primary level is not interesting. There are no playway methods. Approach towards the subject seems faulty. Mm-hmm. And problem in understanding, word problems are very difficult to understand. previous concepts are not clear, abstract concepts are not clear to the students, and problems related to the children, no practice is done, they don't work on time, no homework is given. Nowadays in school, there is no homework given. Stress due to other reasons, preconceived notions and biases towards mathematics, and there could be some learning disabilities. Treatment by teachers, the children are judged and insulted by the teachers. They do not cater to all children, and they promote high anxiety in mathematics. Problems are twisted, so children find it very difficult. And what do the children lack for effective mathematics learning? They lack confidence. They lack the basic concepts. They lack awareness of the importance of the subject. They lack interest. They lack knowledge of simple operations. They lack the love of the subject, and they lack connect with the real life, and a lack of practice and self-study that leads to the mathematics phobia. And there are different kind of fears which are there in our children. Fear of the teacher, fear of word problems, fear of scoring less marks, fear of calculation, fear of maintaining accuracy at all time, fear of parents, pressure to perform well. So these are the different fears.
Yeah.
And what are the different effective teaching methods? One-to-one contact, questioning, peer discussions, hands-on experience, connect to real life, playway method can be used, understand the mathematics language, use constructivist method, use concrete pictorial abstract method, and constant revision. And these are different other creative methods. Awareness sessions can be used. We can remove the misconceptions.
Pictorial songs. Abstract. Okay, songs. From concrete to pictorial to abstract.
Yes. Songs, quizzes, and games can be used. Interactive videos can be used. Meditation can be used in mathematics. Mathematics laboratory activities can be conducted. Out of classroom activities, that's an interesting answer we got, that in the playground, some activities can be conducted for mathematics, and definitely mathematics projects can also be conducted. So thank you very much for your attention. And this was a small research which we conducted. Thank you for your participation. So over to Riesel now for the vote of thanks, formal vote of thanks, Riesel.
Yes, ma'am, thank you. So it is my privilege to propose a vote of thanks for today's webinar. On behalf of St. Xavier's Institute of Education, Manager Father Blaise D'Souza, Principal Dr. Sosama Samuel, our staff in charge, Dr. Vinnie Sebastian, and also on behalf of all the participants, I would like to extend a heartfelt thanks to our resource person, Dr. Veena Deshmukh, who has enlightened us all with an amazing session today. Thank you, ma'am, for accepting our invitation for this webinar readily. And we are really grateful to you for sharing your knowledge and thoughts with us today. I am sure that all our participants have gained some amazing insights on how beautiful mathematics is. Ma'am, you have totally changed our perspective about mathematics and have given us a direction to see mathematics in our day-to-day life as well as our surroundings and appreciate its beauty. You also provided different math examples that synchronized beautifully with nature. As we have now experienced this beauty of mathematics, it will be very useful for us educators to teach students in an effective way and give them the same kind of beautiful experience. Truly, ma'am, your session was so interesting that I am sure everyone would have loved to hear more. So thank you once again, ma'am. We couldn't have asked for a more better resource person. Next, I would specially like to thank our manager, Father Blaise D'Souza, and Principal Dr. Sosama Samuel, for allowing us to continue with Math Webinar Series 5. I would like to thank and appreciate our staff in charge of the Mathematics Pedagogy Unit, Dr. Vinnie Sebastian, for motivating and encouraging us to continue with this webinar series. My heartfelt gratitude to our student coordinators, Clarice, Alsona, Rachel, Daya, Nisha, and Riesel, for being the strong team behind the curtain and providing technical support. And last but not the least, a big thank you to all the participants for your presence. Without each and every one of you on Zoom and YouTube, this event wouldn't be successful. We hope that you're taking back something with you from today's session. So once again, thank you for making this event a success with your enthusiastic participation. With this, I end my vote of thanks.
So thank you all student coordinators also.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. They are doing very well and doing good.
Yes.
And Dr. Vinnie also. Yeah, Vinnie is always there, but students with all their assignment and all their homework studies, they are also doing it very good.
Vinnie ma'am has given opportunity to be.
Good.
Yeah, so it's a
ma'am,
good,
I would not be able to do it without them, ma'am.
Yes, very good.
So I really thank all the students for being along with me to conduct this webinar. It has been a big support for all of us here at SSIE that we are continuing this 1 month webinar. It is very difficult otherwise to continue without your support. So I really acknowledge everyone's support here when I'm conducting this webinar, starting from Madam, all my colleagues, Father Blaze, and all the students who are there with me all the time when we are conducting the 1 month webinar. We also hope that we are making some difference in the mathematics teaching also through our college. We want the there's some difference that is happening. So please write to us and please tell us what is happening on your side after listening to our webinars. So we now over to Rachel for the final announcements for the participants. Rachel?
Yes.
Rachel, can you hear me?
The instructions are regarding the feedback form by the webinar. Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, can you hear me?
Yes, yes. Very clearly.
Yes, ma'am. The instructions are regarding the feedback form. By the end of the webinar, we would be posting the feedback form on the WhatsApp webinar group. We are keeping the form open till 11 p.m. So all the participants are kindly requested to fill the feedback form before 11 p.m. While filling the form, make sure you enter your correct email address or else the certificate will not be delivered to you. If you don't receive the certificate, please wait for 30 minutes and check your spam folder. If after 30 minutes, you're still unable to get the certificate, kindly message any of the students' coordinator regarding the certificate. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, Veena ma'am, once again. Ma'am, Veena, please. Ma'am, can you hear me, ma'am?
Yes.
Ma'am, thank you once again for accepting our invitation and thank you for being here. It was a great session. We learned a lot from your session, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thanks to you, your team, your ma'am, everybody. Nice session. Nice experience to me also.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Bye.
Yeah, so logging off now. Ma'am, can I end the meeting, Father?
Yes.
Father, you want to open?
Yeah. Yes, you can end.
Thank you very much, everyone. I'm ending the meeting.
Yeah.